Good morning, everyone. Happy St. Patrick's Day, which brings us to March 17th of 2024, and we now begin the trek to at least episode, maybe, I don't know, 300. So, onward, I guess, is the onward and upward. So, for those seeing this for the first time, be it live or be it on my YouTube channel, where I'm a little bit behind on, I know. This is really my journey through AI, GPT, large language models. It really mimics what I've done throughout my career to learn these new technologies or to immerse myself in these new technologies. So there really isn't any rhyme or reason as to how it's happened for me over these years. Again, I know I talk about this site every week, but it's important because there's no, as you watch how I kind of preface this and you watch what transpires, each week, the it's not a straight line. There's nothing about this that has ever been this crystal clear. You start on day one, you finish on day 90, and you're done. On these new technologies, my adults say, morning, Carol. You need to build a foundation. I'm a huge believer in this, only because it's something that I wish I could tell you this was my plan when I first started my career. I never really understood this concept of a foundation and then building the skills off of that. And when I look back, there's so many examples that I've had. I think it culminated with the creation of an open source office that really helped bring a lot of these disparate pieces and parts together. And I've really been using that experience on a go-forward basis. So again, depending on where you are in that spectrum, these four very broad general categories to me just seem to make the most sense. And that's really what I talk about for the next, you know, 20 some odd minutes. It really is about proactive preparation. There's no, you know, the days of reactive are long over. If someone came up to me and said, George, I'm 4 years behind, how do I even start here? It becomes very hard. I mean, yeah, you dive in, I get it. But understand this is the journey and the journey's not a straight line. That's probably the easiest and simplest takeaway. So three interesting articles this week. I probably had more. I want to spend a little time on these because there was a lot of thematic things in these articles that touch upon, again, things I've talked about throughout the years that I think we're starting to see pieces of this starting to come together. Now, the first one that I saw, was from adage.com. And it says how an AI digital human cabin crew is bringing a new level of customer experience. So it says artificial intelligence bring marketers the chance to reach consumers efficiently, enhancing the overall brand experience and empowering consumers with tailored recommendations. We're going to talk about that and personalized interactions. The right AI means buyers can enjoy a seamless experience from personalized product recommendations to instant assistance, enhancing their satisfaction and confidence in the brand's ability to meet their needs efficiently and effectively. Now, the funny part about this article, and I'm going to put this out in the chat so you guys have it here. Okay, so you got that. So, you know, this is an interesting one because to me, we've talked about, or I've talked about, the fact that when you're looking at this generative AI, when you're looking at this space, I'm going to put my enterprise architect hat on for a second. There is a stack, and one of the stacks that we talk about is this thing that's called the presentation layer. But as you start going through the different layers of all of this, you learn different capabilities that you need to support such a platform. Now, the interesting part to this is it was read, and I've talked about this whole GenAI thing really being a change to an organization in terms of how you engage, because at a minimum, it really is the presentation layer. It's about how you're trying to expose your company or engage the customer for the benefit of both. Give me a second here. Where was? says this can be particularly helpful when it comes to making pricey purchases such as booking a flight, where a host of stress-inducing logistics and concerns can come into play. The challenge is how to do this while making AI helpful, relevant to your product, and trustworthy. We've talked about trust before, in the eyes of the consumer who might be hesitant to embrace a virtual assistant. Now, remember, we've talked about, well, I talked about way 2 years ago, we were even talking about virtual reality. So there's a number of pieces and parts that are coming here. One piece becomes the AI interaction, right? What do they know about you? How can they help answer the questions? How can they help create an experience? That's, let's call that the generative piece here. There's the other piece of how do you want to engage your customer? Are you going to engage them through an avatar? Are you going to engage them through speech? Are you going to engage them, even a call center? And a call center can potentially use these tools to help answer those questions. So there's this range of possibilities, shall we say. And remember, here's the, let's go back, 6 months ago? No, 1 week. No, it wasn't 6 months ago. This is about March 3. I think it's about 2 months ago now, where that Ford dealership put a GPT chatbot up and it sold a car for $1. You know, someone gained the system and was able to get a car for $1. Realize that we still have a human in the middle here. So as sexy and as, you know, interesting as this may seem, realize that it's still prone to hallucinations. It's still prone to mistakes. We're not there yet. So when you think about this, you know, when it talks about replacing humans here somewhere, remember, there are certain risks. Now, there's going to be a trade-off between how much will you let the generative AI do? How do you test it? How do you harden it? You know, all of that's not talked about in this article. That's how I look at the article. That this is, I think, a good thing, especially if it can help answer the most, you know, common questions or common issues that people had. The question is, where is that line from general knowledge to specific knowledge, and how do you best manage that? I don't know yet. Where was this other thing here? And this is what's going to catch the eyes of investors, and this is what's going to catch the eyes of management. Since launching Qverse in 2022, the immersive virtual tour that lets you try before you fly, which I thought was kind of funny, we've seen over 1,000% return on ad spend and more than a 200% product return on investment. More than half of the customers on the site acquired by this immersive experience were first-time bookers. So, yeah, there's the curiosity aspect of this. There's the, you know, experimentation where people are probably saying, hey, did you see this? How could we duplicate it? So I'm sure there's a fair amount of that going on as well. But to me, this was the sentence that just grabbed me. For brands considering investing in AI, remember, you are not just selling a product, you're selling a whole experience. And this is why when I've talked about bolting AI on, and you know, you think about, hey, I've got these series of capabilities. And again, we talk about it being the presentation layer. Well, is that presentation layer an app, or is that presentation layer truly an engagement with the company or the entity and an individual? And to me, if you're going to use this, you really do need to reimagine the entire customer experience. Just going through it. To start, Sama will be able to answer popular questions about baggage allowance or traveling with children. Clearly, there is going to be I said this last year, pretty sure I said this last year, you know, even on call centers, where if you think about this in terms of layers, one of the first things we want to do is we want to have a conversation. There's a reason why people press zero to try and get to a person. Now, getting to a person from a company perspective is expensive, right? Anytime you get to the person, that's the most expensive pathway. But people usually have they want to express their problem in terms of a question. They don't want to press buttons. They don't want to have to understand a menu or a navigation path. They want to talk naturally. So to me, being able to talk naturally and get some of these low-hanging fruit questions answered quickly, to me, I see huge value in that, because you really want to get, when somebody has a question, you really want to have that increased level of engagement so that you can potentially capture that information and train these models further. Sama is not there to replace a human being. Well, you know, we won't, I think it depends on what set of glasses you're wearing there. She's there to support customers 24/7 in real time using voice and text. Ultimately, customers will be able to ask, Sama, could you book me a flight from Doha to London? Well, ultimately, I think we've talked about, right, the Ford car being sold for a dollar, truck being sold for a dollar. I'm sure that there are certain gates and checks that are going to need to be put into place. So what do I see here? Keep in mind that companies should never just add AI to stay on trend. I've said this before. It should have a real use case and empower customers. Use caution and customer priorities to feed your AI. Your AI should know your customers well enough to feel like a helpful friend. Now, this gets back to the thing I put out. Geez. In April or May of last year, where we talked about this whole concept of trust. So realize that now we're getting into this next level of, let's say you were using this particular chatbot or virtual assistant. Well, you're going to feed it, or it's going to have access to certain pieces of data about you. You're going to build out an experience. That experience is unique to that particular virtual agent, assistant, whatever you want to call it. Nothing from this would move over to, you know, something over here where, let's just say you're using Office and OpenAI, and let's just say Microsoft put a virtual assistant, you know, over top of this. And for those that remember back in the day, remember Clippy, the little, you know, clip that came up and was kind of a little virtual on-screen assistant? Doesn't take much, you know, much creativity to say they could potentially bring that concept back and marry it to a ChatGPT to help you get some of these things done. So to me, this was a really good article to get you thinking about the possibilities. This really didn't have to do about the technology of AI. It didn't help to do about learning something about AI. To me, this is all about the experience. Oh, wait, Mike, come over here. Yeah, Mike, I don't know if that's the, I'm not sure which one that is, but there have been this concept of attacks on an LLM. The second you expose something, I'm sure that there have been a threat, you know, bad actors that have been working against these LLMs. Again, I know the Ford example was one. Hang on a second here. Can I block this person? Yeah. Okay. Person was now blocked. So again, I thought a really good starting article, get your head wrapped around this. It's about an experience. It's about really transcending what you've traditionally done within a browser, within a mobile app. To me, this is about a whole experience. So I think I beat that one enough, but to me, that was really thematic. Now, let's go all the way over to the other side. This came out, I believe, last week. Give me a second. Do they put dates on these things? This was March 11th. Right, March 11th? March 11th. So this was a time, I actually had seen this, I think, from LinkedIn, and I followed the chain on this. Exclusive. U.S. must move decisively to avert extinction-level threat from AI, government-commissioned report says. Now, I got to walk a fine line here. I tend to take these things with not a grain of salt per se, but we need to at least be asking questions and not take these things at face value. Because as you're going to see in the article, it does talk about some of the challenges with doing this. So I'll start with the title piece here. Where am I here? So currently, frontier AI development poses urgent and growing risks to national security. The report, which Time obtained ahead of its publication. The rise of advanced AI and AGI, which is artificial general intelligence, has the potential to destabilize global securities in ways reminiscent of that of the introduction of nuclear weapons. AGI is a hypothetical technology that could perform most tasks at or above the level of a human. Such systems do not currently exist, but the leading AI labs are working toward them, and many expect AGI to arrive within the next 5 years or less. Now, that's this belief. Don't know. We clearly haven't gotten there yet. So the question becomes, how real is the threat? Number one, because we know processors will get faster. We know that algorithms will become better. But when do we get this point of something being sentient? How do we get to something being all-knowing? How do we get to this something that's, you have to put it in control of something. It just doesn't magically take control of something. So that's kind of a starting point. Now, this is a long article. Mike, I saw, yeah. I mean, all of the companies have had the pin, right? This is the, you know, the goal is to get there. Well, they've been working on it. A lot of smart people have been working on it for some time. In fact, as we've talked about, geez, years ago, AGI is not a new thing. We've been doing this for what, 40, 50 years. Now, the fact that we've got better processors, the fact that we've learned a lot is great. But remember one very basic reality. For everything that man knows, we don't know how this works. We don't know how the brain works. So we're trying to mimic something that we really don't know how a brain works. So when they talk about this AGI, now mind you, am I in the bowels of these conversations or am I, you know, I'm not in the middle of them, but we have to kind of take a step back and say, what do we know and what don't we know? Well, what we know is that the current state is interesting, but we also know that for all of the value or the what's the word? Value. For all of the uniqueness of these large language models, they still have hallucinations. They still can make mistakes. They're still not sentient. They're still not thinking. So for all of the wonders that you can do with a large language model today, realize that there's still this chasm between what those models do and where human thought and human sentience is. So when I hear about this, you know, AGI is going to take over the world. That's why on these, you know, when we start talking about these studies, did they have biased individuals on this? And again, I'm not saying that they were or weren't, but these are the types of questions to say, well, wait a minute, where are we? Where are those people? What, you know, what are their motivations? Did they come into this completely unbiased? Did they have previous relate? I don't think anybody asks these questions. So when I see a government commissioned report, you know, don't take the headline and run with it. Do a little of the underlying research to say, well, wait a minute. I'm sure there's value here, but you know, where, which pieces should we be focused on? Now, as you will see, this is a long, as I scroll through this is a long article. I was skimming it again this morning. Let me see if I can find a couple things that I thought were just of interest here. So a basis, the three authors of the report worked on it for more than a year, speaking with more than 200 government employees, experts, and workers at frontier AI companies like OpenAI, DeepMind, Anthropic, and Meta as part of the research. Accounts from some of those conversations paint a disturbing picture, suggesting that many AI safety workers inside cutting-edge labs are concerned about perverse incentives driving decision-making by the executives who control their companies. Now, there's a certain, I guess, fairness to that statement from the perspective of we know AI can be a differentiator. We know that most of these companies, let me just go through this again. OpenAI is not public yet. Google's public. Anthropic was AWS, I think, is behind that, and Meta. So at least three of those have some commercial entity behind them helping to drive that. Clearly, they're investing money with the hope of return. So that's at least the minimum. And we know that Google has had some, you know, slip-ups on their journey. So there's at least, and we know that, by the way, we know that some of these companies have gotten rid of their quote-unquote governance safety teams. So there's at least pieces of truth and attributes that we can suck out of this that are okay, that's helping us paint that picture. Good. Recommends a set of sweeping and unprecedented policy actions that, if enacted, would radically disrupt the AI industry. Congress should make it illegal, the report recommends, to train AI models using more than a certain level of computing power. Well, as we covered, last year, I think it was last year, good luck in getting this one through, because this is where you've got these interesting dynamics. So let's just say the US did this, right? Whatever this was, again, it says more than a certain level of computing power. US law doesn't apply to anywhere else in the United, in the real world. So the question now becomes, you've handcuffed development here to be contained within these rules that other people are basically not playing by those same rules. So already you've got this dynamic of who's going to control that level of compute. And oh, by the way, there are actors that are always going to find ways to circumvent the system as such. So I know that I didn't cover it. I've got the articles. NVIDIA is working on their next series of processors. Again, faster, you know, bigger, better, faster, blah, 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 blah. Okay. If somebody were to say, we're going to limit the speed at which these things can run, well, all that tells me is that now people are going to find ways to take the existing chipsets and be able to spread that work across multiple chips. There's always a way around the problem space. So I'm not sure how this concept of being able to, you know, kind of keep the genie in the bottle is going to work. Because there's too many different actors, and we're in a worldwide theater that, you know, the United States putting policy together when the rest of the world doesn't follow it. Not sure how that works. The new AI agency should require AI companies on the frontier of the industry to obtain government permission to train and deploy new models above a certain lower threshold. Authorities also urgently consider outlawing the publication of the weights or inner workings. Blah, 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 blah. I don't know how you do this. This is where, when I look at these, you know, kind of these government commissioned reports, there's value, right? Okay, you've kind of provided the insights, maybe some thought leadership, or at least ideas to consider, but how do those pieces and parts apply worldwide? Who's going to enforce them? So to me, this is where it gets it gets problematic to balance those recommendations and understanding what those recommendations are versus in a worldwide economy where your laws only have a very specific scope. How do you make all of this happen? The report, even if this went up to the UN. The UN can come up with quote unquote policy, but there's no other government that's going to be bound by it. So to me, it's interesting reading, and there's probably things we can glean from this, but how does it get applied in a worldwide economy? I don't know. The report was commissioned by the State Department in November 2022 as part of a federal contract worth $250,000. It says it was written by Gladstone AI, who I've never heard of before, a four-person company that runs technical briefings for AI government employees. Parts of the action plan recommend the government invest heavily in educating officials on the technical underpinnings. Education is a good thing. Okay, fine. It was a 247-page document to the State Department. The recommendations do not reflect the views of the United States Department or the United States government. Okay, fine. Let's look in here. Blah, 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 blah. Outlawing the training of advanced systems of a certain threshold may moderate race dynamics between all AI developers. The proposal is likely to face political difficulties. Absolutely. I think this recommendation is extremely unlikely to be adopted by the U.S. Let's look here. Jeremy and Eduardo Harris, the CEO and CTO of Gladstone, have been briefing the U.S. government on the risks of AI since 2021. The duo, who are brothers, say the government officials who attended many of their yearly briefings, but told them the responsibility for dealing with them fell to different teams or departments. You know, blah, blah. I'm just looking. Again, I think it's a good read. I'm going to go back through and read this again. But to me, it was more of, how do we take this information and really get a community of people that are going to help, you know, put these checks and balances in? And I think we're in a world of these quote unquote bad actors that, you know, we're seeing this, you know, the bad actors aren't going to pay attention to this guidance. So, oh, by the way, then we've got some of these models are being open sourced. They're not commercial, they're open sourced. So the problem of putting boundaries around this is going to be difficult, if not impossible. So you've got the Time Magazine article. I think it's a good read. The last thing I had for today, and this came out, I believe, this week. We talked about last week, you know, training is going to be something I'll be sharing. This is one of a couple that I'll be sharing. And again, I just started going into this. I think you need to create an Amazon account so that it's free. A couple of the links within the article kind of went to a generic page, but Amazon aims to provide free AI skills training to 2 million people by 2025 with its new AI Ready commitment. Amazon's AI Ready initiative comes as new AWS study finds strong demand for AI talent and the potential for workers with AI skills to earn up to 40% more in salaries. I always ignore that one. That's why Amazon is announcing AI Ready, a new commitment designed to provide free AI skills training to 2 million people globally by 2025. Keyword there, globally. To achieve this goal, we're launching new initiatives for adults and young learners and scaling our existing free AI training programs, removing cost as a barrier to accessing these critical skills. So this is the article here from the AWS site. So you got that. As you go through here, if you go down a little bit, the three new initiatives. There's eight new and free AI generative AI courses. Amazon Web Services Generative AI Scholarship, providing more than 50,000 high school and university students globally with access to new Gen AI courses on Udacity. And new collaboration with code.org, designed to help students learn about generative AI. So this is one of several that I found that are free. I have not yet attended it, but I will be. And again, I'm assuming that there's a certificate that comes out of this that you can then put up on LinkedIn or whatever. But these are the types of training that I'm going to start talking about probably towards the end of each week, of things I'm finding, things I'm reading, classes I have attended, and ideally certificates that this drives. So let me see some comments here. Oh, absolutely, Mike. GPT mimics what we don't know. We trust me, we do not know. We don't know how the human brain works, so we're trying to mimic something we don't know anything about. Yeah, and we've seen it with the Google, right? You know, this idea of bias. How do we eliminate bias? It's something we've talked about. You know, I can bring that up again over time, but you know, don't buy into all the gloom and doom just yet. There's pieces and parts that are valid, but we're not there yet. So the missive continues to be the same. If you're not putting 30 minutes a day into this, as you can see just by three articles, this is a lot just to take in on those three articles, and this is but a drop in the bucket of the bigger space. So if you're not putting 30 minutes in a day, I'm telling you, you're doing it wrong or you're doing yourself a disservice. Take that for what it's worth. And for those, you know, seeing me for the first time, welcome. I do this every Sunday at 9 a.m. It's really my reading or the articles that I thought were of interest. There's no editorial staff. It's just me. There's nobody behind me putting this content together. You're getting this kind of George unfiltered, as I like to call it. I tend to be on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. I use YouTube as my repository. So if you do go out to youtube.com/keeppace, you will see that I do have a playlist of the previous episodes. I know I am behind. Hopefully today I can start, you know, chipping away at that. Basically, what I do is I take these episodes, I cut the dead space. You know, it's like a minute and a half at each end, and maybe I adjust the sound and I upload it. But now it's one massive playlist, and in the descriptions you have the links to the episode. You have the links to the articles that I reference. So that's so rather than have to slog through my Facebook or, you know, LinkedIn profile. Here you go. And then if you follow me on LinkedIn, you'll also get the notification just in case you forget. So that's what I got there. So that brings us to the end of episode 20. 201, I guess, on the march to 200 and something, and God willing, episode 300. So have a great rest of your Sunday. It looks like it's going to be a nice day out. Try and access at least the Amazon training. I can tell you this week, that is one thing I will be doing to at least get that set up. And we will be back again next Sunday to do it all over again. So until then, everybody, stay safe. And I'll see you next Sunday. So take it easy, everyone. Bye.